Good morning. Well, it's such pretty out there. We've been having so much rain here and there, you never know when it's morning and evening sometime. But good to see you today. Let's all stand and turn to page 8. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Let's sing with all of our hearts today.
See you today. Appreciate you being in the house of God, and we do want to give Him all the glory, especially after the week that we had this week in Vacation Bible School. What a blessing it was to spend a week working with not only our children, but children in the community. Saw a wonderful response, especially from the kids, and the Vacation Bible School was just different enough. I think even the teachers and the workers got excited about a lot of the things that we were doing. So it was just a privilege to be a part of that. We'll show you a little bit later in the service. We'll show you a real quick recap video of that and a trailer for next year. So you can already be thinking and praying about what God might have you to do next year in that. I want to make sure, I know I gave Miss Marie a visitor's card. It's good to have you with us today. Appreciate you being here. It's good to have Brother David and Sister Lisa Brown with us. Brother David will be preaching here in just a moment. But do we have any other first-time visitors with us this morning anywhere? I saw Tyler come in, and I'm not sure. First-time visitors, right back there, buddy, Brother Tim. Anybody else? Well, it's a privilege. Appreciate you being with us today. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you just giving you the praise and the glory because truly great things you have done. Father, from the salvation of each and every person here that knows Christ as Savior to protection and watch care, Father, just all the things that you've done for us, the wonderful week that we had in Bible school, you truly are worthy of our praise, and to you should be all the glory. Father, I pray that you'd be with each and everything that's said and done here today, all the children's churches that are meeting around the building. Father, I pray that you would just touch And Father, that those who were there would hear something afresh. If they're lost, they'd see that need of a Savior. Father, if they've been a Christian for a while, something would be said that would stir them to serve you even more faithfully. And Father, we ask the same thing here today in our sanctuary. I pray that you'd be with Brother David as he comes to preach here in a few moments. I pray that you'd use him, touch him. Father, I pray that you'd anoint him and then touch our hearts, Father, to be obedient to the truth of your word. We give you the praise and the glory for all things, and we ask it all in the sweet and precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. As far as our announcements go, first thing you see in there is the school supply drive. And I meant to ask about this, and I forgot. It said school supply drive. We'll be going to Miller Village to hand out backpacks filled with school supplies. Then it lists the school supplies there. What's the date on that? Okay. Okay, so the list is out front if you want to do that and donate. There's a list out there, and you can see all the things that we need there. Choir practice today, 4:45. With a support group, Thursday, July 20th at 12 o'clock. Senior adults meeting Monday, July 17th, tomorrow, 6 o'clock in the banquet hall. It's an ice cream social. The ice cream and the cones and the drinks are provided, so bring your favorite toppings. There is a sign-up sheet in the foyer for that. Junior church picnic is Saturday, August the 5th from 11 to 4 over at Laurel Run, shelter number 11. There's a sign-up sheet there as well. And then Saturday, August the 12th, we're also having a church picnic, and it's going to be at Warriors Path, shelter number 5. Try to get there around 4:30. We'll start eating about 5 o'clock. Hamburgers, hot dogs, drinks, paper products will be provided by the church. But we'll need volunteers to bring the fixings and side items. Again, the sign-up sheet's out there for that. It's broke down by the type of side item and that kind of thing, so you can sign up there. Operation Christmas Child, small toys, stuffed animals, small balls. Or if it's flat, it will need one of the little hand pumps. And then the homeless missions, still accepting donations of individually wrapped snack foods, gallon-sized bottled waters, blankets, gently used T-shirts, socks, and backpacks. Again, there's a box out there, and of course, as we've said, Miss Wendy and Brother Tony are overseeing that, so see them if you got any questions or comments. Any announcements that I forgot? Yes, Miss Tanya needs to meet. She said she's already talked, I think, to everybody, the ladies, but she needs to meet with you all right after the service today, all right? Any other announcements? Any other announcements? Well, you pray and you join us as we sing, all right?
Let's all stand and turn to page 80. Page 80. With you, child of sorrow and of woe, it will joy and comfort give you. Take it in wherever you go, precious name. Joy when his loving arms receive.
precious name. Oh, how sweet hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name. Oh, how sweet hope of earth and joy of heaven. At the name of Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet, hope of earth and joy of heaven.
You may be seated. Before we sing this song this morning, we've sang it some months ago, I was thinking on this song and flipped on the radio when I went out to get in the car this morning and heard a song that kind of went along with it. Do you remember the day that the Lord saved you?
Amen.
You remember that day?
Amen.
You know, so many times as we in the walk with the Lord, I've heard people say, well, I've been in the way for 40 years. Sometimes that's what they've been in the way. Because they don't do what the Lord sometimes wants them to do. Help us not to forget where the Lord's brought us from.
Amen.
And what he done for us.
Amen.
Because when we get lackadaisical and we take the precious name of Jesus and the blood that he shed, and we take it for granted. There's people all around us dying, going to hell. And we sit on the church pew sometimes and we take it for granted. But help us not to forget what the Lord's done for us, because, man, he's brought us from a mighty long way. And we've got a lot to thank him for. Worship as we sing this morning.
Yeah.
Let's all stand for our fellowship song, page 526. I like singing this just every once in a while just because it is so good.
Victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever.
I know it. Be careful, we got traffic jams in both aisles. What a blessing. What a blessing. We've got a couple of things we want to do here. Number one, we'll do the kind of the review of the Bible school and the trailer after Brother Ron sings. But before he comes up, we got one other little thing. Many of you have probably seen this already on Facebook, but wanted to take just a moment and recognize a couple of wonderful things. Number one, Brother Andy and Sister Amanda are now engaged, and we praise the Lord for that. And then Sister Sarah and Campbell are engaged. If you didn't see that on Facebook, I saw that late yesterday. So we praise the Lord. What a blessing that is. You pray for Brother Ron as he comes, all right?
Well, you know, I'm not going to sing without saying something first. And the reason I do that is because I get so nervous. And I told them, I was telling people, I'm glad that there's a pulpit up here because you guys, whatever hand I have down here is just shaking like you wouldn't believe. You'd think I'd have some kind of, had some kind of problem or something. But you know, Vacation Bible School was a blessing this year. It kind of goes along with this song. It talks about this week we learned a lot about how much Jesus loved us and how much he went through for us. You know, sometimes we forget that. And I was telling Pastor Tim, I had missed a few years of Vacation Bible School. And I missed about 3 years of being in and out, being able to come just every now and then. But I thank God that I've got a church family that stayed behind me and prayed for me and treated me like a brother. And I look around here and I see faces and I can think of different things that I've been through with each and every one of you. Funny things. Things we cried about, and things you were there for me when I was crying. I was thinking yesterday was Gabe's anniversary of him passing away, and it brought back a lot of memories. But I got to tell you a story, and I kind of posted this on Facebook about half a month ago. I was doing a paper route, actually the paper route that I live on, and I came to a stop sign, and I said, I've been here before. 19 years ago, stopped at that same stop sign for about 15 minutes and cried my heart out because I said, I'll never be happy again. And you know, sitting there 19 years later, I cried, but I also was happy because God's taught me a lot through those 19 years. He taught me I can be happy again. Taught me there is life past our bad experiences in life. There is life, and it goes on. And we can choose what we can do with it. And I know a lot of people that have chose. Once they have that bad thing come in their life, they live there for the rest of their life. And I could see that happening. But God doesn't give up on me. He never gives up on me. This song talks about your grace still amazes me. His love that he has for me still amazes me every day. I know I'm not worth it to a lot of people. But in God's eyes, He loves me. And He embraces me every day. And He takes me through all those bad times. And I don't want to hear that as a Christian, you're never going to go through bad times, because there are going to be bad times. We were talking about Elijah. After he had his great victory, what came? A bad time. And we got to know that bad times are going to come in our lives. But what do we do after those bad times?
Oh, the rivers of Babylon. There we
several. Went back some two or three times during the week just to learn more about what Jesus had done for them. So you pray that the seed that was planted or watered bears fruit here in the near future, all right? It's just a blessing. Let me say how much I appreciate each and every person that had a part in the Bible schools. You can tell it looked like they had a good time, and the workers had a good time as well. So I just appreciate everybody's faithfulness and helping with that. You be much in prayer for next year. Already got stuff on order, getting ready to do the new one for next year, sometime June, July time frame, depending on how it all works out. So you just be much in prayer that God would bless next year's Bible school as well. Well, it is a privilege for me to have Brother David Brown and his dear wife Lisa with us today. Brother David and I have known it. We've known each other. We've known Sprint and I've known them for probably well over 30 years because we went to Double Springs just right after we got married, just a few months after we got married, and met Brother David then. He and I co-taught the youth together and did a lot of other things, we've just always kind of hit it off. We were in a youth meeting one day, and they'd had a pig roast, hog roast, out at Double Springs. And, of course, you know what you have to do in order to have a hog roast. And somebody decided to bring a pistol instead of an actual rifle. And I think they unloaded a clip in that poor pig to get to take care of it so we could roast him. And so David and I are teaching the youth. And I can't remember which one of the Conkin girls it was, but we were sitting there. And she said, "How did they kill that pig anyway?" And before I could even think of something to say, David said, "Lead poisoning." And I had to leave the room. Like I said, we've got a lot of that sense of humor, that dry sense of humor, we've gotten along for many, many years. And it's just a privilege to have him with us today. You pray for him as God just uses him to speak to our hearts, okay?
I've got a green light.
You're good.
We know what that means, right? Go. Well, it's good to be here. I appreciate the opportunity, Brother Tim. It's always a blessing to be invited to preach at somebody's church, you know, especially somebody you know. I knew Brother Tim before he started coloring his hair. So, and he knew me when I had more hair. But it's been a good. It's hard to believe, around 30 years. That's amazing, isn't it? So it's been a blessing. I've enjoyed the service already. Now, I was thinking about when Brother Tim called me. I don't know how other preachers are, but usually within 5 minutes of the phone call, my first thought is, what am I going to preach? And I don't know. And this message came to mind, and I looked at other things. You know, it was a message that I already had shared. Brother Drury, you and Sister Debbie, y'all may realize or recognize this one, but that's okay.
Right.
You know, I have some messages I preach once, and I don't preach them anymore. I have some that I'll preach multiple times, some that I'll preach for special occasions. And this one here is after what I've saw this morning, you look for confirmation. I do. And we're going to be talking about kids. We're going to talk about children today. So I pulled in the parking lot, and I said, well, they got a playground, so that's a plus. You know, and then lo and behold, you just had Bible school. So I said, well, they like kids. Y'all like kids, don't you?
Amen.
How many of y'all have children? All right. Now put your hands down. How many of y'all have grandchildren? I do too. And they're the stuff, aren't they? They are, aren't they? I hear that a lot. They are. They're a blessing. Now, we've got two grandchildren. We've got an 8-year-old grandson. His name is Maverick. They live in Mississippi. They moved to Mississippi. His dad's in the ministry, and they moved down there to be a part of a church there. So they have Maverick. He's 8. We also have just turned this past Monday a little granddaughter. She just turned 1 year old, and her name. And I don't know our kids; they grow on you. But her name is Roosevelt Hollis, but we call her Rosie, and she's just special. She's a little redhead. So I don't know if she's going to be fiery or not, but they're precious, aren't they? And boy, they're just something you want to have around. I always like going to a church where you have children. You know, I've heard people say, well, that's the church of the future. No, it's not.
Right.
It's the church of today.
Right.
Brother Malone, I believe is his name, he talked about they have children's church, children's ministry downstairs. So you're discipling, you're growing those children today. In your church. They're a part of your church. You know, we over the years, we've had kids that we'd go out with the van ministry, the bus ministries, and bring them in. They're part of the church.
Right.
And thank God for them. You know, you make a difference in a child's life when you have them sitting on a pew, sitting in a class. You know, you may lose some of them along the way, but what God has done in their lives, it'll be there. I believe
right.
When God does a work, it's a lasting work. So I'm going to look at some things this morning. And you look at the times that we live in. I know times have always been evil. There's always been evil people in this world. But we're living some crazy times, aren't we?
Right.
We are. And I'll just tell you this up front. Now, my normal ministry is I do assisted living. I go to, it used to be Remington House. It's now Brookdale. But I've been doing that. This will be the 21st year that the Lord has allowed me to do that. It's a privilege. It's a blessing. To be able to, I don't know if any of y'all have ever been involved with that type of ministry, but we're talking about the people that built the churches that we sit in today and enjoy.
Right.
Folks that are up in their 80s and their 90s, and what I'm getting at is I don't consider myself a loud preacher. Now he might turn me up to make me loud, but I'm not a loud preacher because I've learned that people up in their 80s and 90s, they don't like to be hollered at. So I don't know. Maybe it's they're here and they can't get that volume just right, and I don't want to blow them out. But so I don't consider myself a loud preacher. I don't consider myself a preacher that's going to be all over the place. They asked me, I go over to Brother David Powers' church, Brother Tim's father-in-law, and they say, well, what do you want? Well, I say, well, the podium mic's fine with me because I'm not going nowhere. I'm like the fellow that sang this morning. You know, I'm going to keep my knocking knees hid because preaching is one of the most exhilarating things you can do, but it's one of the most frightening things you can do.
Right.
I don't know, does that make sense? But that's the way it is. So this will be, I surrendered to preach in March of 2002. So a little bit, but I'm still nervous. I still get nervous. I still do. If you teach Sunday school, you know, I get nervous doing that. I believe that's just how God keeps us honest, isn't it? He keeps us on our toes. But I want to look this morning, and the title, I like to title my message just because it gives me a train of thought. I try to depend on my notes so I don't chase rabbits so much. I hate to see you've got a clock back there. I hope it doesn't work. I wear a watch, and like I was always told, what does it mean when a preacher looks at his watch? Absolutely nothing. So I just wear it as an asset on me, as an accessory. But the title of the message, if I titled it, would be Building Fences for Our Children. Building hedges. And I believe that's something that we should be doing. That's something we should be involved in. And this is a message that I thought about today. This is a message for moms and dad. And this is a message for grandparents.
Right.
This is a message for great-grandparents. Why do I say that? Because the times that we live in, we see today, yes, there are parents raising their children, but sadly we see their grandparents. And that's not always just because the kids wouldn't do it. There's things that happen in life. But we see grandparents raising their kids, and I have also saw great grandparents raising their kids. And that's just not, unless just can't be avoided, I don't believe that's God's design. He wants mom and dad to be a part of that. He wants dad to be the head of the household, to provide for the family, both materially and spiritually. And I believe that's God's design. I believe that's scriptural. So that's why I want to share this message today, but I want to share a verse because the times that we're living in, I was thinking about this verse this morning, Over in Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, the Lord was talking to the Israelites through the prophet Isaiah, and he said there in verse 20, he said, "Woe unto them that call evil good, and good evil, that put darkness for light, and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet, and sweet for bitter." And that's kind of where we're at, isn't it? They're saying these evil things, they're okay. But then they want to say what's good, oh, that's all wrong. And we live in a twisted society at times. It's not everywhere. We're very fortunate to be where we're at, where we live here in East Tennessee. We live in what's called the Bible Belt, but that belt is getting tarnished. And we need to shine it up. We need to let our light shine. And we need to be willing to be a witness to our children. Very, very familiar passage of Scripture. I'll get into the message. Again, I don't want to take a lot of time. Y'all get usually done, what, around 145, 2, somewhere right in there? All right. Well, then the pastor said it's okay. So we're good. My dad, when I first started preaching, he said, "David, I'll give you this advice. You need to stand up, speak up, and shut up." So I'll try to do that this morning. But I hope I can share something today that'll be a help to you. But I want to look here, a very familiar passage of Scripture, and we'll get into the message. But Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, probably familiar if you've ever worked with kids. But he says here, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." God gives us some good instruction there, doesn't he?
Right.
And I like that word train there. I look it up in the Hebrew, and it means to narrow. It also means to discipline, and it also means to dedicate. You know, I thought about our girls. We've got two girls. There are 6 years between them. And we had both of them. Before they were a year old, we had a dedication. We dedicated them to the Lord. And boy, that paid off, I tell you now. Because within 6 months of one another, the oldest girl, they moved to Mississippi. And then it wasn't even 6 months. It was a very short period of time. The youngest girl and her husband moved to Portland, Oregon, just outside of Portland, Oregon. Now, they both moved for a good reason. The oldest, they moved because he's a pastor. And the youngest, they moved because there was a church plant out there in Oregon and they needed help. But we thought back, well, we dedicated them. We gave them to the Lord before they were even a year old. And that time came, you know, that God said, okay, now I'm going to use them. Now I'm going to put it to work, what you said you would do. So it makes a difference. I would encourage you, if you've not dedicated your children, dedicate your children. It'll make life a lot. Well, it won't make it so much easier, but it'll make it more understandable. Because, boy, it's a burden to have them move out of home, move out of the house. It is. But that word train, I like that word. It means to narrow, and that's really what I keyed in on. That's what we need to do with our children. We need to narrow their way. Because kids, they want to go in all different directions, don't they? That's just what they are. That's who they are. But we need to be able to narrow that way. And that's what I've tried to do with my girls. Maybe I was too disciplined or too harsh at times. We learn, don't we? Right. I've learned. I've learned there's no such thing as a professional parent. And if you tell me you are, I pray for you because I don't think you're telling me the truth. But we all have failures. And that's a hard lesson to learn when your kids get grown and you hear conversations, and they're saying, well, this and this, and you did this and that. And you think, man, I messed up a little bit there, didn't I? And we do, don't we? You know what we do? We do the best we can, don't we? But the best we can is trying to raise our kids according to the Bible, according to God's Word. And if we can do that, then we've done all we can do. And that's what we try to do. I was strict. My oldest girl, I told her, I said, Whitney, we were just trying to keep you alive. You know, that was our goal, because we didn't know anything about being a parent. And she's fussed at us with the 6 years later, our youngest girl, Leah, came along. And she said, you let her get away with everything. Y'all get that too? I said, I can't win. I'm too strict. I'm too lenient. So I don't know. I don't know where the middle. We didn't have any more after that. I thought, well, I'll just ruin the next one completely. But we just don't know. But we need to be able to train our children. We need to narrow that way. There's times in my life, in my teenage years, I was the only one in church. Well, No, I wasn't. I didn't get saved until I was 19. But there was a set of years there when I didn't have any boundaries. And I wish I had boundaries. I would go ask Dad. Our home was in a mess. It was a godless home. I was raised my early years in a good Christian home, but we got out of that. and we got on the wrong in the wrong. And I wish that I had had boundaries. There was times that I actually went to my dad and asked him if I could go do something with some of the guys running around with, and I was hoping he would say no. Isn't that crazy? But even as a lost teenager, I knew. I knew there was things that I shouldn't be involved in. But we need boundaries, don't we? We need some things to hem us in, to keep us on the right path. So, I thought about this. I thought about people write books. I don't care how many books you may have wrote on raising children. There are some things that we need to get right in raising our children and even having a part in the lives of our grandchildren. Now, I don't try to tell my daughter and son-in-laws how to raise their kids, but I subtly, we can drop hints every now and then. Just the expression on your face sometimes can give a little hint, can't it? I don't think there's anything wrong with that. We should have a little bit of part in their raising. But there are some fences that I want to talk about today that we need to have. And we'll talk about at least five fences that we should have, we want to have in our children's lives. We want them to build them. We want them to maintain those fences, those hedges. That's really the term I should be using, is the hedges. Because that's the term we'll find in the scripture that we're going to look at. But I guess I'll share this and we'll go on. But I got part of this message probably back in 2019. There was an old preacher down in Mississippi. We went to visit my daughter. His name was Ira Singleton. He had been preaching, I think he preached 70-some years. He knew a little bit, He had seen a few things, but he preached a message that Sunday night on what's important to you. But right before he started preaching, he said, sometimes maybe I should share my message on building fences for your kids. And he gave me just these few fences. He said, we build fences from the time, even before kids get here. He said, we build, the first fence we build is the cradle. We bring them home, we put them in that little cradle, they're not going to do anything. They're safe, they're secure. And he said the next fence we'll do is we'll have that baby bed. We'll move them up a little bit. And then he said the next fence, we'll put them in that room, that little nursery that we've worked so hard to get everything just right in. And then finally, we'll let them out in the yard. We've got that fence, we've got that gate, they're safe. And then he quit. He wouldn't give me any of the points of the message. I couldn't believe it. So I had to put the message together, but that's okay. He gave me the thought for it. So I always like to give him credit for that. Now, he passed away in 2019 at the age of 93. And it's just amazing to see how God had used him over the years in his ministry in Malawi, Central Africa, different places, different Baptist boards he'd been on. But God used, and he used him that night. He gave me two messages. Now, he gave me part of one. This is it. And so if it's messed up, it's not his fault. But what do we do with a fence? What's the purpose of a fence? I think that's a fair question. Well, it's to set boundaries, isn't it? And what's that old saying, good fences make good neighbors? Maybe a lot of truth to that, I don't know. But it's proof of ownership, which should be important to every believer. Whose children are they? Are they the school system's children? No. Are they mama and papa's children? No. Are they the neighbor's kids? No. They're your children. You own them. In a sense, but we really don't, do we? We give them back to the Lord. The Lord lets us have them and raise them, but they're ours to raise. They're ours to care for. So it shows fences and hedges, they set boundaries. They also are used to keep unwanted things out. Well, what in the world would a believer want to keep out? I'll tell you what, look around you. There's a lot you want to keep out of your children's lives today. There's a lot of good reasons to have a hedge in the lives of your children these days. To keep good things in, I think that's a good purpose for a fence. What would a believer want to keep in? I want to keep all the good things. I want to keep the things that we've done. We've tried to teach our kids right from wrong. We've taught them to try to teach them to pray, to be faithful in whatever endeavor they've set out to be honest. All these things. I want them to be able to keep those things in. You use a fence or a hedge to keep valuable things secure. Well, if there's one thing I want to keep secure, and when my kids were at home, I said, that's the most valuable thing I've got in my house. And I want to keep them secure. But I learned that I can't keep them. I learned that they get in the backyard, and they'd have bicycle wrecks. And you just, even at home, you have to have the Lord, don't you? Right. But you have to have those hedges in place in their lives. But there's going to come a day, I realize, when they grow up, and they're going to find that gate in the yard. And they're going to go at it, aren't they? They're going to go off to school. They're going to go off to friends and start spending the night there. They're going to start doing all these things. They're going to get outside of the realm of mom and dad's total influence on their lives. They're going to start being influenced by others, aren't they? Now, some of those influences will be good, and some of those influences will be bad. They'll be wrong. But what did I do before they got to that point? I believe you can do a lot before that child gets out of your home and gets out into the world. And I believe that's something that we should have as a goal. We need to teach our children, and I'm going to use this word kind of interchange, but fences, because that's one of the meanings for the word hedge. I looked it up in the Hebrew. I don't speak Hebrew or Greek. I know Greek when I see it, and I bet you all do, don't you? Because you just look at something, you say, well, that's Greek to me, so we know it when we see it. Now, Brother Tim may speak Greek. I know he reads it. He works with it, but I don't. But I looked it up in the Hebrew, and we'll look at that. But the verse I want to look at this morning is in Job chapter 1. It'll be a very familiar scripture. But God, I believe, is in the fence or the hedge building business, and we should be also. Let's pray briefly, and then we'll look into the message. Father, I thank you for this time. I thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here today. I pray, God, that you'd just take this message, Lord. Lord, you know what's needed. I pray, God, that you'd use it in a way that would be pleasing to you. Lord, just be with each one, Lord. The most important thing that happened this morning, Lord, is the Holy Spirit would bless this, Lord, your word. He'd take it and he'd use it, Lord. If not today, Lord, at some other time in the lives of these people, Lord. I pray that, Lord, you just use it in a mighty way. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Job 1:10 there. I remember thinking about this. The question that the Lord asked the devil here, he said, "Hast thou considered my servant Job?" You know, I preach a message that kind of touches on that. You know, there'll be times in our lives when God may insert your name in there. Hast thou considered my servant, Tim, Jerry, I don't know the name, David. He may put that in there, but that was the question he had put to Satan. And then he goes on here in verse 10, Satan has a response to this. There in verse 10, it says, "Hast not thou made an hedge about him? And about his house, and about all that he hath on every side. Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land." So God had truly placed a hedge about Job here in this scripture. He is a hedge of protection. And I don't know about you all, but I pray for a hedge of protection. I pray for that hedge of protection on my children, on people that's just friends. You know, God place that hedge about them, protect them, guard them. Take care of them. And I believe we all do that. If we don't, we should, shouldn't we? And I believe God, he honors that prayer. He answers that prayer. And that's what he had done here for Job. And God, I believe he's placed a hedge about all of us. Because if he hadn't, we wouldn't last a minute. We wouldn't probably even last a minute, would we? So God has placed a hedge about us. And we need to realize that we have a great need for hedges. He's done that for us, but he does the same for every believer. But you know, there was nothing going to come inside that hedge that God didn't allow. You know that, don't you? So we think, well, this is just a horrible thing, but God has allowed that in our life. Now, I've been dealing with what they call tinnitus. I woke up in January the 20th to be exact, and I thought I was going deaf. I had a tone in my ears. And it was deafening. And I thought, my stars, there's something bad wrong. And I'm supposed to go see I'm starting to see a neurologist now. So if I'm a little odd, you know, that's why. But God has allowed this in my life. I don't know. But I know it's done something for me. It's helped me to be more prayerful. I know there may be somebody at some point that I'll run into that's having this issue. It'll drive you nuts. In my case, a little bit more nuts. But it'll get on your nerves. God allows things. God has allowed this in my life. And I don't understand it, but I just have to trust the Lord that he's going to take care of it. And he has. He's helped me through it. He's toned it down. It's at a pretty high pitch this morning. I don't know if any of y'all ever dealt with tinnitus, but it's just a constant ringing in your ears. And it can get on you. But I thank the Lord he's helped me through this. Well, he allowed these things. He's allowed this through the hedge in my life, is what I want to say to you this morning. But we will look at these hedges, and as I thought about them, sometimes we get the bright idea that I'm a mature Christian. I can handle this. Lord, you just hang back and keep my back there. And we get in trouble, don't we? We try to break through the hedge. We try to go somewhere that we shouldn't go. And God has some good advice about that when we attempt to do that. When we try to go through the hedge, when we try to go through that hedge of protection He's placed in our lives. He says in Ecclesiastes chapter 10, verse 8, "He that diggeth a pit shall fall into it, and whoso breaketh an hedge, a serpent shall bite him." I think sometimes we need to thank God and just go on for the hedges He's put in our lives. So that's what our Heavenly Father does. He puts things in our lives a lot of times that we don't understand, but they're there for our protection. If you have children, I know growing when my girls were growing up, they would ask us to do something or whatever it might be, and the answer would be no, and they'd look at us like we had two heads. What on earth could possibly be wrong with that? And all you know is just you know that no is the right answer. You can't explain it. But you know that knows the right answer. Y'all been in that position? It's something, but I believe that's just the Lord. He's just saying, no, that's good enough. There's no need for an explanation. Sometimes there's no time for an explanation. So we get that idea, but God says, whoso breaketh an hedge, a serpent shall bite him. Well, who's represented in the Bible as a serpent? It's the old devil, isn't it? That's exactly who it is. He's always waiting, isn't he? And I just say that some things are best left alone. God has set those boundaries. We need to leave those things alone. But the word hedge, if you look at it, it's only used, what I could find in the King James Bible, the word hedge, singular, it's used 9 times. It's used 8 times in the Old Testament, and it's used 1 time in the book of Mark in the New Testament. So not a lot of usage, but you will see it other than the word hedges is used a few times. But if you look at the word hedge, it means to entwine. And an example of that is to shut in. And the purpose is for formation. I believe that has to do with that discipline in those formative years. I believe those formative years are a lot well beyond the age of 18 at sometimes. They are, aren't they? You know, I thought I knew everything at 18 and 19 and 20 and 21. And my dad died in 2008, and I was up in my 40s, I guess. And I still don't know everything. So I still need those hedges, though. I still need that forming. But it means for formation, it means for protection, it means to restraint, and it means fence. So I don't want you to think I'm just picking a word, but it does mean fence. And I thought, well, that's something we can understand here in Northeast Tennessee. We know about fences, don't we? We know about them electric fences anyhow, don't we? Run that green piece of grass up it, then you dance. That, we know about that. But there are some hedges I believe that we need to have in our children's lives. I will look at those. I believe the first hedge that we need to have in the lives of our children is the hedge of salvation. And I believe if you look at this message, I say we got to get these things right. We got to get them right. So, because some things you just don't get second chances at, do you? And we got to have that hedge of salvation, that protection of their eternal soul. And I believe that should be a goal in your children's lives. Now, fortunately, our girls, we had them in church from the time they were born. We were in church. And I remember I was able to go into the room with both my girls at one point in their life and go through the plan of salvation with them. What an honor, what a privilege that is to be able to do that. Now, my oldest girl, she made a profession of faith at, I think, 6. She came back to me when she was about 12. She had some questions. And we went back through the plan of salvation. She got saved at church. But we went back through it. And she pretty much led me through it. That's a wonderful thing about children. Amen. You know, if you keep them in church, they'll lead you through that. Of all the people I've ever led to the Lord over the years, children have always been the easiest. Because you sit down with them, and the God has always, He's already prepared that little tender heart. They already know. Come on. Now, don't argue with them. If they come back to you, that's fine. Never force it. You don't want to force it. But I've had more children than I can do on my hands that they've shared the scripture with me. They've led me through the plan of salvation. What a wonderful thing. But that's the first hedge I believe you need to have in a child's life is the hedge of salvation, that hedge of protection needed to protect their eternal soul. And if you get that right, then the rest of it will be a lot easier. It'll be a lot easier for you to deal with. But at some point, a child will be led to or they'll come to this fence of salvation, as I call it. They can't climb over it. They can't go under it. They can't go around it. There's only one way to the safety of the other side of that fence, and that is through the gate. Who's the gate? It's Jesus Christ, isn't it? And that's what we have to do. We have to come to that place. We want our children to come to that place. They realize they're lost, they're in need of a Savior. They've got to make a decision. And the right decision is to get on the other side of that hedge where there's protection. And just like you said, Brother Tim, it's through Christ. We need to try and do our best to win our children to Christ. Now, if somebody else had won my children to Christ, I wouldn't have been mad at them. Well, thank the Lord for that. Thank God He used them to do that. But we need to have that hedge of salvation in our children's lives. Matthew 7:13, he talks here. He says, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." Thank God when a child comes to a place in their lives and they realize they're lost. I've never argued with a child, but I've asked the question when they come to the altar or they come to for counseling, why are you here? And I get quiet. And if they can't answer that in the right way, that they understand why they're there, then we'll do this another time. But God, through the Holy Spirit, He knows. He moves that heart. He moves them in the right direction. And I believe that's a hedge that we should desire, that we should be a number one hedge. I believe we build in our children's lives, and it's a hedge that they maintain with the help of the Lord, that they grow in the Lord. Again, Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Now, you know, I said this is for moms and dads, for grandparents and great-grandparents. Well, I realize that God in His wisdom, here in verse 6, He said, train up a child. He didn't say your child. And I believe God in His wisdom, He knew there would be times for through adoption, whatever it might be, that you might be raising someone else's child. And I think back of a lady that we had over at the Remington house. She raised her niece and nephew because their mother, she just didn't want to be part of their lives. But she raised those children, and it was a wonderful thing. I got to help preach her funeral. She had requested that, and the boy, he came to me before the service. He said, "Could you just say something about somebody else raising somebody else's kids?" And I thought, well, I don't. And immediately this verse came to my mind, to train up a child. That's what she did. Her name was Lena, just a wonderful lady. She'd sit there in the services. She'd praise the Lord, just a sweet lady. They were raised in a good Christian home, and I'm thankful for that. But she had helped them build that hedge in their life, that hedge of salvation. And it doesn't matter who it is, but the thing is that matters is that it takes place, that they have that hedge of protection in their life. I hope this message, I hope it makes sense. You know, Brother Tim, we worry. I do sometimes. I think, can I say it the way I want to say it? Can I say it the way I want to understand it? You know, you lay in bed at night and you'll preach messages. I don't know about other preachers, but I've done that. You'll preach, boy, I preach some good messages laying in bed at night. If they could just get from the bed to here, it'd be wonderful. I never seem to meet the mark, but we do the best that we can. So we can't force them. You know, I thought about this. We take them to the gate. We present Christ to them, but we can't force them through the gate. But we can make sure they know where it's at, can't we?
Right.
That's all we can do with anybody, is make sure they know how to be saved. And it's always sad that you see children, they children raised in Christian homes, and they're lost. They're lost all the way up into their teen years. And boy, it really starts showing itself then because of the influences. They've stepped outside that gate of the fence there at the house. They've got out into the world, and they have no hedges in their lives. And we'll talk about some more of those hedges. But we need these hedges in our lives. So that's the first hedge, I believe, that we need. The Lord said in John 14:6, He says, "Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Now, I say that because there's a lot of people out there that will give you a lot of different answers on how what it takes to get saved. It's through Jesus Christ. Period. End of story. That's it. He's the only one that we can be saved. Acts 4:12, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." So it's through Christ. So that gate that I took my girls to was Christ. Christ alone. And I'm thankful for that. So we need that first hedge, the hedge of salvation. Then the second hedge I thought we need is the hedge of prayer. We need prayer, don't we? How many of y'all pray? Boy, you better raise your hands now. All right. We pray, don't we? Why? Because we need it, don't we? It's something that we need in our lives. We make our requests. We make our petitions to the Lord. We need prayer in our lives. Each one of us do. I know I do. I need prayer in my life each and every day. But, you know, something I can't do for my girls, I couldn't pray for them. I could pray for them, but I couldn't pray in their stead.
Right.
They had to pray. We had to teach them to pray. I'm thankful for my wife. Every night, without fail, that I can recall, she was in the bedroom with the girls at bedtime, talking to them. I'd be praying with them, teaching them to pray. Now, every now and then, the youngest one in particular, she'd ask me to come in there and pray with her, and that's fine. But that was just something that was a part of our home. I believe it should be a part of any Christian home. I believe that's something that God would have us to do. We teach our children how to pray. Because, you know, there's going to be times when mom and daddy ain't going to be there. And they're going to have to know how to pray, aren't they? And they should know how to pray. So I believe we need that hedge of prayer. You know, prayer is, to me, it's a source of peace. You know, you pray and you just trust the Lord. And you say, Lord, that's all I can do. I can make my request to you. It's a source of peace, but it's also a source of security. Also, I think it's comforting that we're able to pray. You know, we went through this COVID. And I tell you what, and I don't know about you all, but I don't like being sick. And what I was hearing, you know, I know there's people that they died because of this. And I'd lay in bed at night and pray, you know, Lord, protect us. Lord, place a hedge about our family, you know. And I think that there's nothing wrong with that. We want to live, don't we? But I wanted my children, I had one in Oregon at the time and one here, or one in Mississippi at the time. I couldn't have helped them. There's no way I could have got to them and helped them in any timely manner. So I wanted them to have that hedge of prayer in their lives. What will prayer do? Well, I believe prayer, it will get them in the right direction. You know, I think back about my oldest girl when they had just got married and they were looking at buying a car. And I went to the place with them, and we all went up there. It was a little family thing. They were going to buy their first car. And she came to me, and she said, what do you think, Dad? Well, I don't know. I'm not the one that's going to be making the payments. So you know what my advice was? I said, have you prayed about it? I said, go pray about it. So they went and sat in the car, and they prayed about it. I believe they got their answer. They purchased the vehicle, and it was a good little vehicle. It was running great when they traded it. But yeah, it's something simple, isn't it? But it's something that was necessary. It's something that's necessary in all areas of their lives. We need to have that hedge of prayer in our children's lives. And we need to teach them how to pray. It gives us the light. It gives us the right understanding. It gives them peace in uncertain times. Philippians 4:6, he says there, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God. Then he says in verse 7, I like what he says here. He says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Have you ever prayed and you just had peace? You just knew, I've done what I should do. I've prayed about it. And it's in God's hands. You know, I want my children to have that. I hope you want your children. Hope you want your grandchildren to have that. That peace, that hedge of prayer can be in their lives. So we have that. Now, we teach our children to pray. What's that little prayer? I lay me down. How's it go? Y'all help me. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. We teach that, don't we? You know, that's a scriptural prayer. And it goes back to Psalm 4:8. David said here, he said, I will both lay me down in peace and sleep. For thou, Lord, only makest me to dwell in safety. And I believe that's what prayer gives us. You know, our little granddaughter Rosie, my daughter, I believe she prays with her. My grandson Maverick, I believe he's prayed with at bedtime. I know each one of them, they have a book. They read to them. But prayer always needs to be a part of that, doesn't it? We teach them young, don't we? So we need that hedge of prayer. I hope I'm not going to be long, but I'm gonna be long enough. How about that? But I think we need this hedge here. This is a very important hedge. I believe we need the hedge of God's Word in their lives. Now, I believe we should teach our children to read their Bible on their own. I believe we should hopefully instill in them a desire to read their Bible. Not just to read it out of habit or because mom and daddy told them to, but to read. And I was amazed. I'll use my girls. I'm very thankful for my girls. And I'll give my wife more credit than I'll ever get for it because she's just a good mom. But they read their Bible, and my youngest girl, she'd come to me, and we'd have good conversations about the Bible. Boy, she asked some tough questions, though. They make you dig, won't they? But I'm thinking, well, I didn't teach her this. Where'd she learn it? You know, maybe she heard it at church, but they come to you with things they've found in the Bible, the Word of God. And that's because, thankfully, I believe we put that hedge in their life. We put that boundary in their life, something that they need. And I believe that's a hedge that we need to have in their lives. And what does that hedge do? Well, first of all, it's used to keep bad things out and good things in. Is it not?
Right.
Oh, I believe the Word of God, it does that. He tells me what's wrong, what I need to avoid. He tells me what's right, what I need to be involved in. He does. It's very simple, isn't it? We kind of muddy the waters and make it something else. They say there's no absolute truths. Now, I'll take this from somebody you know about, Josh McDowell. I've got a book there at the house. I think it's called Right from Wrong. And he talks about, you know, the degeneration of young people at that time is as if nobody knew what was right. Well, it might be right for you or wrong for you, but it's okay for me. And just that's just confusion is what that is.
Right.
I believe God settles the matter. There's right and there's wrong.
Right.
There's no middle ground. Now, there's right timing, but there's no right. There's no difference. You know, if I do something that's sin in my life, it's sin in my life. And I need to admit that. And if my children do it, it's sin in their life. I told my girls that. I said, if daddy does it and it's wrong, it's wrong. And if you do it, it's wrong, it's wrong. It's just that simple, isn't it? So we need to have the hedge, I believe, of God's Word. Absolute truth. I like the definition he gave for this. He said absolute truth is that which is true for all people, for all times, for all places. Absolute truth is objective, it's universal, and constant. Well, what is that? What do we have in our life that is constant? It's right here.
Right.
It's God's Word. It does not change, does it? And I would encourage you to be careful about the version that you have. Now, I use the King James Bible. I'm stuck with it. I'm going to stick with it. I learned something the other day. I was amazed. You know, I hope you don't have one. If you have an NIV, go try to look up Matthew 7:21. Oh, it's just a footnote. And they've took verses out. But if you're going to have that hedge, you need to have the right hedge. You need to have the Word of God. And God has kept it. He's kept it. And I thank the Lord for that. So absolutes are right and absolutes about right and wrong are not based on feelings or opinions. Just because you feel good about it doesn't mean it's right. You know, we talk about, we make fun of the 60s generation because that was the feel-good generation. You know, if it feels good, do it. Well, boy, we had a mess come out of that, didn't we? We had a mess. We had a lot of damaged people come out of those years. I lived a little bit. I mean, I wasn't big enough to know what was really going on. I was just a little guy during that time. But he says, I'll read a verse here, but they have to set their own boundaries. And I put this in here because mom and dad won't be there to do it. And I told my girls this early on. I said, look, Whitney, Leah, you're going to get to an age, you're going to start going places, you're going to start being involved in things, and mom and dad are not going to be there. And your friends are going to want you to do something, to go somewhere, whatever it might be. And I'm not going to be there to say yes or no. You're going to have to make a decision. And without that hedge of God's Word, knowing some absolutes, knowing right from wrong, they most likely would make the wrong decision. And that's just true. My kids want to make a decision, I hope it's based on truth. And truth is God's Word. That's the only truth that you can make a good, solid, right decision on. So I believe we should have that hedge in their life, the hedge of God's Word. Psalm 119, verses 9 through 11, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? And that's the question. He says, by taking heed thereto according to thy word. Thy word, he says, I have I hid in mine heart, that I might not sin against thee. That's what we need to do, don't we? We need to have our children. Where does that hedge exist? It exists in their heart. You know, you can get stuff in your mind, but well, when you get it in your heart, you'll act on it, won't you? You'll live by it. And we can say that for our children. We say that for our adults. Now it'll help us to prick the right friends, too. Now, I learned this a lesson the hard way. I made some bad decisions on friends I chose. I was lost. But I picked some wrong friends when I started my freshman year in high school. It took me 4 years to get out of that. It actually took me longer than that because I was still messed up even when I graduated. But it was just bad. I wanted my girls. I told them, you make sure you pick the right friends. And it helped them because I would have them come to us and they said, there's just something not right about this. You know, we'll be around them, but we're not going to be their friend. We're not going to hang out with them. And I'm thankful for that. Well, we need that hedge. We need the hedge of God's word in their lives. You know, what's it going to do? Well, it's going to protect their good name. It's going to protect their reputation. It's going to protect their testimony. That's the same for mom and dad, isn't it?
Right.
Your testimony. It takes years to build a testimony, but it only takes just a split second to ruin it. My grandmother always told us growing up, she said, David, it just takes a minute to get in trouble, but it takes a long time to get out of it. I thought that was good wisdom. Now, we're on number four, so I promise you we're getting close. This hedge here, I think sometimes folks don't like to talk about it. It makes them uncomfortable. But I believe it's one that we need to talk about to our children. I have two girls. But I want to talk to you this morning about the hedge of purity. You know, we don't talk about that. We live in a day when there's a lot that our kids can get a hold of. And it's not pure things. It's not God's design. I'm talking about the things that go on premaritally. You don't have to be vulgar in talking to your children about these things. But there's some guidelines that God has gave us about purity. And I believe it's a hedge that our children should have in their lives. I believe they should have that hedge of purity. The word purity means the quality or state of being pure. And I believe we need that. Now, I'll say this. Please don't go on dates with your children. Just don't do that. It's just not. It just never comes out well. But we should teach our children, boys and girls, how to act properly when they get to an age when you decide to let them start dating, and they should know what it is to keep themselves pure. We know. Well, you all know exactly what I'm saying. We're all adults here. I don't have to go into anything. But you know what? I sat down with both of my girls, and I talked about this, and I talked about them. When you're with a boy, you need to conduct yourself. And if I'd had a boys, I would have done the same thing. Why did I do that? Because I'm the head of the house, and that was part of my job, I believe. Was I comfortable? No, I was not comfortable at all. I think I was shook up, but I had to do it. And I believe that's a hedge that we need to put in our children's life, because there's so much promiscuity. I don't know if that's a good word, but it's something that's not respected. And God says it's something to be respected, that part of our lives. It's for marriage. Let me say it that way. Let me just be blunt. It's for marriage. That's by God's design. And our children, they need to have the right attitudes and the right actions in both dating and marriage. It carries into marriage. This hedge that we place, this hedge of purity, there's just so much just horrible things, I don't evil in this world right now. And it is so accessible for our children, but it's not right. And we need to have this hedge of purity. They need to have this hedge of purity in their lives. You know, I've already said you feel comfortable about talking to your children about these premarital relationships. Well, let me tell you this. Rest assured, if you don't talk to them, there is somebody out there that will.
Right.
There's somebody out there that don't care about them like you do. There's somebody out there that don't love them like you do. They will talk to your child. Now, that child could be a little bitty guy, or that child could be college age.
Right.
But these are conversations. This is a hedge that we need to have in our lives. And we need to have it in our lives as adults, and surely we need to have it in the lives of our children. So I would encourage you, have that conversation if you have not already. Because it'll make a world, it'll help your children have that hedge when their mom and dad's not there to say yes or no, they'll be able to make the right decision. That's the best we can do in it. But we need to build these hedges. Now, if they want to break through that hedge, we know that's not good, don't we? According to Ecclesiastes. And sometimes we do. We're bullheaded. We're hard-headed. I know I was growing up. You know, didn't listen. And a lot of times I paid for it. Dad said, if you won't listen, you'll have to learn. Well, Dad was right. I learned a lot of times. I don't want my kids to do that. Me and my wife, I prayed. I said, Lord, please don't let them ever get involved in anything that I was involved in. Because I was unsaved. And I got into some really silly things. I like to use that other word, that stupid word. I did some of those things. You live to regret those things. I wish I had had these hedges in my life growing up. And we think about this, but God is very, very plain about this. We go into the Exodus. Exodus chapter 20, verse 14. He says, thou shalt not commit adultery. But he also is in verse 15, he says, thou shalt not steal. Now, I had an old deacon tell me this years ago, and I thought, well, it's harsh, but it's true. He said this. He said, for a young man or a young woman to take the purity of another young man or a young woman, they are stealing. They are taking what is not rightfully theirs. That's true, isn't it? It is. Because premarital relations, that's not right. The marriage bed is for the marriage bed. And that's by God. That's by God's design. So we need to have that hedge of purity in our lives. And God has much to say about that. You can look in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 through 20. You can look in Matthew chapter 5, verses 27 through 28. Now we'll come to that very last hedge, I believe, that we need to have in our children's lives, and we need to have in our lives also. We need to have the hedge of faith. When all is said and done, when we've read our scripture, we've relied on our scripture, when we've prayed, when we've done all these other things, we come to this place and we had to have just the hedge of faith. I call it Mama's hedge. And it's simply this, it's because I said so. Y'all ever have that? You ever go to Mama and say, well, can I do this or can I do that? She'd say, no. Well, why? And she'd just look at you and say, because I said. She's not going to explain it. And we need that hedge sometimes. We need that hedge is not just because Mama has said it. It's just because I'm going to have faith just because God said it. I don't understand it, but God said it. It doesn't say God said it and I believe it. No, that's not the way it works. Right. It's God said it, and that's the way it is. It's that direct statement principle, I believe, there in hermeneutics. It's God saying what he means and meaning what he says. Now, I always hated when Dad told me that. He said, I mean what I said, and he did mean what he said. And that's faith. I had faith that Dad was serious. And we need to come to that place. We need to have that hedge in our lives. When all that can be said has been said, and all that can be done has been done, then we go to Mama's hedge, because I said so. And that's where we need to be. That little simple verse here in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. He says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. But I like what he says here. He says, and lean not unto thine own understanding. There are times that we will not understand. There are times in our children's lives they will not understand. All they have to go on is faith. God will do what's right. And that's all we'll have sometimes. You ever been in that situation? Yep. I don't understand it, but I know that God will do what's right. I have to put my faith. I have to have that hedge of faith in my life. I have to have that hedge of faith in my life daily. Lord, it's up to you. I can't do anything. That's what I've done with this tonight. I said, Lord, I can't fix it. The doctors can't fix it. I've been to this one and that one, and they can't fix it. If it gets fixed, Lord, you'll fix it. That hedge of faith, we need that in our lives. He says in, we finished that verse there, in verse 6, he says, in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. And I'm thankful that he will. We have that promise. He'll get us through it. He'll lead us. He'll show us where we need to go. 1 John 5:4, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. When all's said and done, that's all we'll have. You boil it all down. When you're laying there on your deathbed, what have you got? You got your faith. You've got that hedge of faith that God has been true and God will continue to be true. That's what I want my children. You know, I'm expected to not outlive my children. So these are things I want them to have. When Dad and Mom's gone, I want them to have these things. I want them to have these hedges in their lives. I want them to build these hedges and help their children build these hedges in their lives. I'm thankful that I come here this morning that I see young people in your church. I'm thankful you have young people downstairs in your church, Brother Tim. That's a blessing. So many churches you go to, and they're older. They're older members. And what's going to happen? I mean, we see it in churches all over the place. The older members, well, life takes its natural course, and people pass away, don't they? And your church shrinks, and your church shrinks. So thank the Lord that you all have young people in your church. Now, I consider myself, I identify as young. But, you know, that's not always true, is it? I turned 58 this year. So that's not that old. They laugh at me over at Brookdale. But I believe we need these hedges in our lives. We do. I hope this has helped you this morning. We need that hedge of salvation. I believe that's the most important one. You got to get that one right, and it'll make the rest of them a whole lot easier to get right. That old Holy Spirit, when He indwells you, He guides us. He directs us into all truth, doesn't He? I'm thankful for that. We need that hedge of prayer. We need that hedge of God's Word. We need that hedge of purity in our lives. And then we need that hedge of faith also. I believe that puts the cap on it. That holds it all together. You know, God, I can't remember Your Word. I'm getting, my memory's getting worse and worse. There's things I used to be able to remember, I can't remember. But you know, even I can't remember it. This is like the brother asked, do you remember the day you got saved? You know, I talk to those folks over at the Assisted Living. A lot of them, they don't remember. I say, well, do you remember that there was a day? Do you know that that took place in your life? That's the best you can do, that faith. You know it happened. And we need that. We need that hedge of faith. I hope you have these hedges, these fences in your life. If you don't, I hope you start building them. I hope your children, your grandchildren have these fences, these hedges in their lives. Now, I'm not one to give a lengthy invitation by any means. I'm actually going to turn the service over to Brother Tim for that. But again, I pray that God will use this. I tell people when I preach at a church, the best I can do is share what I have peace about. That's all you can do. And I believe this is what God would have us today. You know, I look for that confirmation. You know, now God, He'd already told me, well, this is right. But you always look for that little confirmation. I believe I got it this morning. I believe this was the right message for the day. I hope it's helped you. Brother Tim, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Would stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed as Sabrina comes to play softly. Father, we come to You just thanking You for the truth of Your Word. And thank You for the heart and the spirit in which it was given. So, Father, I pray now that You just have Your way in this short time of invitation. Father, I pray, I'm not Brother David. I think, God, when you move, and people know it. So, Father, I pray that You would just have Your way, and we'll give You the praise and glory for it all. Sabrina plays softly last Sunday morning. The thought of the message was bringing children to Christ. And if you boil down what Brother David said here today, it was the second half of that message. Because today what we heard was raising children for Christ. Do you need to come? Maybe you're a young parent and you just want to pray that God would touch and help you to be the parent that God would have you to be, so that you can help build those hedges in their life. Some have come. How about you? Maybe you're a grandparent and you want to have that godly influence in their life. You want to touch them in a way that they see not only what mom and dad has taught, but they also see in you what you taught them. Some are still coming. How about you? You want to come, and I like what Brother David said, even though he didn't go quite in that particular direction, but it says raise up a child in the way that it should go. And you're a Sunday school teacher or a Rhema teacher or a youth leader, and you want to come and ask God to help you in the role and the ministry that you have here at this church to help them develop the hedges that they have and that they need. Do you need to come? Do you need to come? My Heavenly Father, I come to You just thanking You for the truth of Your Word. Father, how I thank You for the leading that You gave Brother David. Like I said, it just seemed to dovetail right in with last week. And Father, how I thank You for the touch and the unction of the Holy Spirit of God today. Help us, Father, to be parents and grandparents and a church that will always want to bring children to Jesus and then help them to live for Him as well. We'll give You the praise and the glory for all that You do through us and in us and for us. And in Jesus' sweet name we pray. Amen. All hearts and minds clear. Okay. Just remember that. Somebody else. Somebody else. Yes, ma'am. Amen. When I went by there Thursday, he was asleep, and I said his name, but he never would wake up, so I didn't know what. I just kind of left him be. Pray for Mike. Pray for that whole situation, all right? Somebody else. Yes, sir. Yes. Mm. Remember that. Amen. Just remember both of those. Amen. Somebody else? Somebody else. Choir practice, 4:45. Service starts at 6 p.m. tonight. You pray. God just touch in our services this evening. All right? All hearts and minds clear. Brother Paul, if you would, sir.